Yeah, so I texted Gordon and I just shot him an email with the agenda attached, so he has the Zoom link.
Okay, great. All right, well, it is 6:33 according to my computer clock. So I'm gonna call to order the Concord Municipal Light Board meeting for August 10th. And I'll just note that we are missing two board members right now, Gordon Brockway and Pam Hill, both who are expected to attend. So I'd like to proceed knowing that and hoping that they will join us. And then on a temporary basis, Alice, would you be able to fill in as clerk until Gordon shows up?
I will do that.
Okay, I appreciate that. Okay, so of course, the first order of business usually is a call to order, but also we have three sets of minutes that have been distributed. And Brian, thank you for doing that. I do get a sense that people gave edits and then Brian redistributed them the other day. So we have minutes from March 10th, April 14th, and May 12th. To review and approve. I can take those up individually, or we can do them as a group. People are moving.
Am I the only one frozen?
No, well, Brian, I mean, Alice, I can see your face, but not your, you're not your, well, there's a picture of you, not your actual face. But can you hear us?
Better go off video. So we have, I heard 3:10. What's the other dates for?
4:14 and 5:12.
Okay.
Right. As long as you can hear us, we can't necessarily.
Now I can.
Okay. All right. Great. So we can take these up individually or all as a group. I have no comments on any of the minutes in that final draft. Alice, I don't know if you do.
Unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to read the final draft.
Okay.
Because we've been traveling here.
Okay.
So I'm sorry, I didn't get to review the final.
The edits that were made between the draft that was sent a week ago and the one sent a couple days ago are just minor edits. I did answer a question that Laura had about in the middle school discussion, there was option one and option two and the dates didn't make sense. I went back and reviewed the video. It was option A and option B, and the dates do apply. So it wasn't one scenario than the other. So that is corrected. And Wendy had a correction about who had made a motion, and it turned out it was me. And so I put that in there.
Good. Okay. So Alice, were you able to read through the first set round? So
I did.
You'd be comfortable to vote? Okay.
There's only one that I cannot vote on because I wasn't at the meeting. And so I'm assuming, that means we don't have quorum.
Yeah.
I think it was the April meeting that I was not
there. You weren't there. Yep.
So I cannot, I feel like I can't vote on those minutes to verify, but the other two are okay with me.
Okay. So if I would entertain a motion for approving the March and May minutes, so we can get those posted.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So I move that we approve the March and May minutes as distributed.
Second.
Okay. All right. So I'll take a roll call vote. Brian? Alice?
Yes.
And Wendy says yes. So the March 10th and May 12th minutes are approved. And unfortunately, we'll have to defer the April 14th minutes, unless, of course, people join us later in the meeting, at which time we'll... we can review them then. Okay, so it's really unfortunate that Pam and Gordon are not here for the chair's update, because I did have a few updates and I really did want their feedback, but I think perhaps I will proceed anyways. I want to acknowledge our next meeting is September 8th. It is right after Labor Day. And I assume that if you have any concerns with that meeting, is everyone comfortable with September? No problems with that?
Right. Yeah. September 8th, I think you said. Yeah.
Yep. Okay. All right. Just want to check. Okay, so, and I am noting there's a few people in attendance from the public. I want to talk about a few things. I did attend the chair's breakfast this last couple of weeks now, and there was a discussion around the Zoom meeting formats. And I had actually sent after our last meeting, after concerns from citizens were raised around the format that we chose to use, I had sent a message to the town manager and the select board chair about why don't we have a standard for the Zoom format? Why can't it all be the same? And what are the issues and considerations? And so the reality of what I heard is that there are different formats. There's a preferred format that we use here at the light board for the webinar, which is a more secure format. And that sort of avoids the Zoom bombing risk that many of us have. But not all departments in the town have that option because there is a budget expense that's associated with the license for a webinar format. So that explains why there's some variation across different committees in the use of the format. We also discussed in that chair's meeting people's preference for one or the other. People didn't have a preference for one or the other, but there was an acknowledgement that the finance committee, in response to citizen concerns about being aware of who is in the committee, does have an approach to list the number of the public attendees in the meeting. And so I wanted this board to sort of weigh in on the choice of, will we continue the webinar format or consider the more open format? I'll just comment, my preference is the webinar format, and that if we're going to do that, that I would recommend that we have a very deliberate point in time in the agenda where we list the public attendees, so we will be able to address the citizen concerns about knowing who's participating in the meeting. So I would welcome other feedback on that. Alice and Brian, do you have a particular concern or preference in format?
I'd be happy to give my opinion. Since I can't raise, oh, I can raise my hand.
Sorry.
I will do that. I'm sorry. I just think of my internet is unstable. Yeah. I'll do that formally. Okay. Raise my hand.
That's okay.
Yeah. So I'll wait for you to call.
Good. Just, yeah.
Go ahead, Brian.
Oh, all right. So I think I do like the video recordings that come with the web format. I have seen a lot of committees meet in person, but they have a video available through Zoom and people can participate in that fashion. I like the idea, if we keep this format, providing who is an attendee would be great, because I do know that is a concern. I'd rather get back to in-person meetings, but I don't think that's safely possible quite yet.
We'll take that up as a second item. That's next on my agenda. So First I want to talk about Zoom format. So Alice, do you have a strong opinion either way on the format?
So my thought would be, I guess I don't understand. Brian, you said that you like the video recording that's available from the webinar format. Is that not available when it's the non-webinar version, the open Zoom? Can you not record that at the same time? I thought you could.
You can.
So yeah. It doesn't sound like that's the limiting factor if they both are recordable. Right. So if that's the case, if you can equally have in this posted on Minuteman Media, I personally think that having an open meeting where all participants can see each other and can be part of a meeting where you are actively engaged, it's a little harder without being able to see. That would be my preference. I could go either way, but I'm thinking that the problem with Zoom bombing is real, but I think if we can assign or have somebody you take the role to make sure that when somebody who enters who shouldn't be there, which we haven't had yet, nobody's tried to Zoom in, they get booted just like you would in a regular public meeting. If somebody were, somebody uninvited comes to a public meeting and causes a ruckus, we would ask that person to leave or have that person escorted out. It'd be the same situation, whether it's a Zoom or not Zoom. So I think The risk is low, and that would be my preference, to have an open meeting.
Okay. I guess my, just a comment, I think my preference is to keep this webinar format for the security reasons, because the disruption of rescheduling is a risk in my mind. And so the reason why I even asked you is that I was told that the Zoom format is my choice as chair, and I don't think it should be mine. I think it should be the board's, and that's why I'm looking for your insight. So at this point in time, what I'd like to do is suggest that we'll continue to use the webinar format, but we will make a point to list out the attendees, and we'll do that when I get through my chair's update, okay? The second item that I want to talk about was to your point, Brian, earlier about in-person meetings versus hybrid meetings versus Zoom meetings. So that is also an option for us as a board to consider. So, you know, I think there are many people who have concerns about being in person. I could go either way. I don't have a strong feeling on that. I have attended some of the hybrid meetings for different committees, and I've had a difficulty in the video and the audio and had difficulty understanding all the participants. And that might just be the select board's option, but I had a challenge with that. And Zoom right now clearly is working well. I'm fine with that as well. But let me just ask people's input. I don't know if we're ready to do an in-person meeting. Dave, can I just ask that if we did an in-person meeting, is video set up in the light plant?
That was my question.
It's in the process. There's a card in there. There's a TV.
Yeah.
I'd have to talk to Jason a little bit more to see if it's ready, but he's out right now. So, but the idea is that room will be ready for hybrid meetings if the board chooses to use it, or another room as well.
Okay. All right. So I think maybe this, what I'd like to do is maybe Brian and Alice, you could just comment on any preference you have now, and we'll defer further discussion until also Pam and Gordon are able to join us. But do you have an opinion that you want to voice now, preference for in-person or hybrid or Zoom?
I would prefer hybrid if we can get good audio quality through the Zoom participants. Because I do know that, you know, you mentioned about not being able to hear the board or the select board while you're participating remotely. As long as the audio quality is good, I think we go with that in-person meeting, the hybrid.
Okay. Alice, do you have a strong opinion either way?
I also prefer the hybrid model. I think that, I think that having an option of being in person for those who feel comfortable with that, and with the changing nature of COVID and the variants, it gives us more flexibility. I also think it provides a greater opportunity for citizens to participate who may not want to come out at, you know, get up at 6 in the morning or 6:30 to attend our regular early morning meetings. Can attend in their PJs otherwise.
Yep. And I agree with all of you. I think hybrid would be probably the preferred method for everyone. So, all right, well, we will defer that and we'll get a better understanding of when the room is ready. Oh my God, sorry, I can't turn that off. So the next agenda item that I wanted to cover was just an update around the sustainability director. Sorry, I'll try to make this loud. We were solicited for volunteers to participate in the selection process for the sustainability director. I sent emails out to the board, asked for people willing to volunteer, and thank you, Alice and Brian, for volunteering. So Brian, I know that you're helping review materials that are being prepared by the candidates, and Alice, you're going to participate in the interview process. So thank you both for your participation, and hopefully we'll have a great candidate. So that'll be nice. Thank you. The second update is really just around board goals. You know, Alice, you had helped us put some goals together early in January for the board. I just want to comment that we haven't forgotten those goals, and we're going to continue to work on those goals going forward. One of the biggest ones was to look at the CMLP strategy document that we had, and there were a number of initiatives in that document. I'll remind folks that Dave and his team have been updating that graphic of the strategy, and it is out on the website, but we want to be more deliberate, and instead of having one big review of the strategy, we thought it might be better to sort of do a deep dive on on different aspects of the strategy. So we will in the future dedicate time in each of our upcoming meetings to go into a specific aspect of that strategy. So we'll intend to do that, including also the other comment that I had around that strategy was making sure that we incorporate the recommendations from Article 51 so that they're in our strategy as well. So we'll include that as well. There was also a focus on board education that I know, Dave, you and your team have helped provide Pam some background on the board, on the just on our board activities. And today's E&E presentation will go a long way in that direction as well. But we'll also dedicate some time on the time of use education as well. So more to follow in the future, but just want to remind people we haven't forgotten that and we're going to make a commitment to doing that. And then lastly, in terms of sort of agenda management and materials, just want to acknowledge that if we do have agenda items where we're going to have to make decisions and weigh in on something, we're going to make an attempt to make sure the materials are sent in advance so you can be prepared for the meeting. And so that we're going to, it's my commitment to try to get that out with Dave's support. So assume that. So if you're not getting materials, there isn't a decision to necessarily to be made in the meeting. So so we'll see how that goes.
So quick question, Wendy. Yep. With the agenda items, it would be also helpful to, when a discussion vote is listed, to put on there what the question to the board is. What is it that the light plant needs from us as an answer to move forward? Because we sometimes get just a agenda topic and it's a very large topic and we don't know what specific aspect we should prepare to be asked about.
Okay. Okay, that's a good recommendation. Thank you, Brian. Okay, so Dave, with that, I will turn it over to you to get to the director's update.
Okay. So in partnership with Abode Energy Management, E&E, and CSEC, CMLP will be holding community sessions on climate-friendly home heating and cooling and electric cars from 7 to 8:30 p.m. on Monday, September 13th at the Harvey Wheeler Community Center. We'll notify registrants in advance if a COVID condition requires us to switch it to a virtual format. The event introduces residents to CMLP programs that can help them adopt these initiatives and give them a chance to talk to EV specialists, heating and cooling coaches, and owners of heat pumps and electric vehicles. The slideshow on CMLP's homepage provides a link to the registration form, and the event will be publicized through a variety of avenues over the next month. Riverwalk now has officially committed to installing the EV charging infrastructure designed for them during the EV Ready pilot program. Center Village, also part of that program, has received quotes for their charging infrastructure project and is currently in the process of choosing a contractor. We issued a contract and a PO for a third-party consultant to help us with this project. We are in the early phases and there'll be more information provided as the project gets underway. Pamela Cady, our energy specialist, attended E&E's MLP solar program wrap-up meeting last week. DOER funding was exhausted before the end of June 30th. And I'm gonna share my screen just to kind of give you guys an idea of how we did. Give me a second. So here's the graphic. Shows, you know, almost 770,000 for our CMLP.
Wow.
So we had the most projects. I think it was 67. Yeah, so I mean, it was really good. There were 67, and our match was just about 385,000. You know, in addition, since the program began in late 2018, Concord had 22 projects that applied but were not accepted, and 9 arrays installed that did not apply for the program. There were a variety of reasons why the non-participant projects, including shading, azimuth, and the deadline, created some problems. And before I continue, I'm going to ask Laura to give a quick update on the AMI project with the consultant.
Real quick before we move on, Dave, do you mind sharing that chart you showed with the board?
Yeah, I'm going to email it out to you guys.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, Dave. Would it be okay to share my screen, Dave?
Yep.
Okay. So at the board's request, we have set up a separate section of the CMLP website that speaks directly to our 2021 advanced metering system. You can see that it's 8th down on the list. And by the way, Carol and I are working on a redesign of this website so that when you first land on the CMLP webpage, you are not confronted with 20 different tabs. We're going to try to reorganize this in an obvious fashion to be more user-friendly. But in the meantime, we have posted on here our 2021 advanced metering system dedicated webpage. And on here, what you'll find is an overview talking about what it is we're planning to do, how we're going to go about doing it, and what we expect to achieve. And listed now on the webpage is the project timeline and consultant scope of work in abbreviated format, which looks like this. And it talks about when we started our work with the consultant called Lemmerhirt Consulting and what their tasks were. The first of which was to gather information about the CMLP system and then to prepare a systems goals and applications review, which describes how CMLP currently operates, what systems it uses, how it collects data, and how it performs its basic functions. This document is nearly ready for approval. We're needing to prepare a redacted version of it, which does not include a diagram which has very specific information about information flows that we felt could potentially be a security breach and therefore didn't want that out in the public domain. Mm-hmm. So that will be available soon on the website. And when it is available, you'll find it as another tab next to this project timeline. The next task for the consultant is to prepare a benefit quantification study. This is describing what benefits the town anticipates achieving from implementation of the new system. And it will include some dollar figure estimates. Very important to us is the stakeholder engagement and input process, which actually began really in June when we prepared a customer survey to ask customers what they knew about AMI. We were trying to get a feeling for what the awareness level was. You know, what do customers know about AMI? What features would they like to see? What's most important to them? And potential uptake of these programs. And so that customer survey was conducted in July. The results are being finalized. I believe actually they're due today on the 10th, although I haven't seen them yet, but that should be forthcoming. So that was part of the stakeholder input. Another really important part of the stakeholder input is a meeting that is we are planning to have this meeting in September. It will be posted on multiple media avenues, including Twitter, the CMLP website, message inserts, Facebook, et cetera, to let people know that CMLP will be providing our stakeholder engagement expert from Lemahert, who will help facilitate this meeting. And the purpose is to gather input from the public and interested parties about, you know, what they want to see from newer meters, what's important, what's not important, and to gather that feedback. And all this is in preparation for preparing an RFP, which the consultant anticipates releasing at the end of October, early November, with proposals due sometime in late November, early December, a selection to happen late January, early February, a presentation to the board in March of 2022. And then I believe this is a little optimistic, but this is the consultant giving this date and they are the expert. And they have said that they believe that we can have a finalized signed contract for the installation of new AMI meters by the end of May, 2022. What this means is that provided that the materials are available, and we all know due to COVID, and we've heard about circuit board shortages and other things that that may not be the case, but provided that materials are available, we could begin installations theoretically of the new meters, probably in the later parts of 2022, which means most of the installations will probably occur in 2023, and we could potentially be fully implemented by the beginning of 2024. This is important for the board because you need to recognize that as these meters get fully implemented, you will have had to have made, that's a lot of verb tenses, many decisions, including about net metering, time of use rates, heat pump rates, and other associated rate designs that will be affected by the implementation of meters that are capable of measuring and billing for time of use rates. So that's the new section of the website. As I said, once we call it the SAGS report, System Application Goals, I can't remember what the S stands for, SAGS report should be available down here. And then once the benefits quantification becomes published, that will be down here. So that's my update today regarding AMI. And if there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
No, I think that's great. Thanks, Lauren. I love that you actually were able to put it up on the website and all that information is public. That's great. It's very helpful.
So just to finish up my my report on the personnel side, we have four recruitments underway. I previously mentioned we have the class one line worker that's open until filled, and class two line worker that's open until filled as well. We do have three applications that we're reviewing in the class two. The network engineer has been advertised. That closes, that closed today. And there's 18 applicants to review. And then the broadband technician closes on Friday, August 13th. And there's currently nine applicants in there. Okay. That's my update.
That's great. Thank you. That's my clock. All right, so I want to just take a quick break. And as I mentioned, to the degree that we're adopting the webinar format for Zoom, I want to make a point to read out who the attendees are in the session in case the public wants to know. So my little vision problem here. So I'm going to read these out just so everybody knows. Carol Hilton, Dave Allen, there's G. Marcinek. I don't know who that is.
That's Greg.
It's Greg. Oh, thanks, Greg. Janice Hetty, Jess Fitzmaurice from E&E, John Tismorange.
Zimmerangus.
Thank you. Also from E&E, Carlin Reed, Marco Santiago from E&E, Matt Johnson, Pamela Dritt, Ray Andrews, Sven Weber, and Tim Herbert. Okay. So fulfilled that commitment. Okay, thank you. All right, so moving on in the agenda.
Wendy, could I ask a quick question?
Correct.
I've had my hand raised, sorry.
Sorry, I didn't see that. Thank you.
That's all right. So thank you very much, Laura, for that update on AMI. that is a great to have a detailed timeline on how we're going to move forward. That's wonderful. I do have a question because I know the funding for this was approved in town meeting of 2017. That's a long time ago. Is there any update that we need to do to make sure that funding is still available, or is it just once it's approved, we're all set?
No, we should be all set.
Okay.
I'll double check to be sure, but we should be good to go. Okay.
Great. Good question, Brian. Thank you.
I look forward to more updates. I'm excited about this project.
Yeah, yeah, it's good. And so Laura, I'm assuming, is there certain content or summary results that the board should expect to see, like the benefits, some summation of that? Are we gonna see periodic updates, or maybe this is a topic for September, Dave?
Yeah, you will get updates as we go through. And you know, as Laura said, we're gonna be putting that stuff on the website.
Okay. All right.
My feeling is you guys would get it before it goes up on the website.
Okay.
So you're aware of what's there.
Okay, that's what I was looking for. Thank you.
And whatever possible, it would be great if the materials that we were given in preparation for discussion about AMI was also posted there, as long as it's appropriate. It'd be great.
Okay, so we're moving on our agenda. We're right on time. So Matt, I don't know if you're the one giving the update on the audited financials, or Dave, you want to give an intro? I'm not sure.
Yeah, I'm going to just kick it over to Matt so okay. We can stay on time, but he is going to go through it.
Okay, great. All right, and then just the board, you all got a soft copy of the audited financials, and you had the option to pick up a hard copy. I don't know how many people did, but it was there for you.
That's good evening. I'm going to be presenting the audited financial statements and supplementary information for the years ended December 31st, 2020 and 2019. Real quick, I wanted to show everybody, all the attendees, where they can access the financials if they wanted to get a copy. You go to the town's website and then make your way to the MLP website. Down on the left, there's a CMLP financial statements link, and you will see all of our past financial statements for the last 10 years. So first off, I'm gonna kind of just do a high level overview of all the sections and kind of explain briefly what each section is of the financial statements, and then we'll circle back to the financial statements and talk about some of the key highlights. I'm going to refer to page numbers, and when I do, I'm referring to the page numbers at the bottom of the page, not the PDF page. So the first item is the independent auditor's report. This is the opinion. It's a rather lengthy opinion, but we ended up getting a clean opinion, so that's what you always are looking for. The next section is the management discussion and analysis. This is kind of a 10,000 feet overview of the operations for the year. It's a good narrative of what happened if you just want to read through that rather, and if you're not a frequent user of financial statements, it gives a pretty good explanation. So it's a good place to start. The next section is actually the face of the financial statements. These are really the kind of the meat and potatoes of what is in this report. I'll circle back to these and we'll go into these in a little more detail in a little bit. The next section is the notes to the financial statements. These give a kind of a lot more detail behind all the numbers that are presented on the financial statements. It also describes what we are and you know, how we came to be and that kind of thing. So there's a lot of detail in here. Half of the notes is related to pension and OPEB. So if you want to take a nap, that's a good place to go. Towards the very end, we get these, they're called required supplementary information. All of the RSIs that we have are related to the pension and OPEB that I just talked about, and they're required by the accounting standards. And then the last thing I'm going to show you is the split. At the very end, we split the light front from the broadband so you can see more detail of the numbers. This might be the section that you most of you be want to zero in on, because it's there's a lot more detail here. But I'm going to go up and talk about the consolidated financial statements up above. So on page 8 is the statement of net position, which is, if you're in the for-profit realm, it's essentially the balance sheet. The first item I wanted to highlight is the top line is unrestricted cash. You can see our unrestricted cash went down over 3 million, and you'll kind of see why when we get to the very end of this section, why that happened. I believe we did the fund balance policy maybe a year and a half ago, and I think we are currently below our healthy range. So we're going to hope to get out of that pretty soon. The accounts receivable went up, which is expected based on the a lot of the delinquencies and stuff related to COVID. So that's kind of expected. I don't think it's an unhealthy amount. The majority of this balance is unbilled energy. So we know the usage amount, but we haven't sent a bill out to the customer. So we include that as AR, because we've earned that revenue, but we haven't received it yet. Moving on, the restricted cash is also, oh yeah.
Matt, can I just ask a question? Because you made the comment about the unrestricted cash, but I also saw that we had a big increase in prepaid expenses. So, obviously we can do that, but that probably accounts for a big piece of the drop in those unrestricted cash, right? Because you've paid stuff in advance.
Yeah, I think it does.
Okay.
Yeah, so the majority of that, and you know what? Actually, I'm going to go down to the notes real quick and see if I can find that prepaid note. Because there's a detail of it. So that right here, it shows a breakdown of the prepaid types. And the obviously where the big increase was is this purchase power. And all of that cash or money is sitting in an account at E&E that's going to be spent on future energy costs. They take money out of that fund and then we replenish it as they take it. So that's the big difference there.
Is that simply a timing issue?
Yes.
Of when you replenished?
It happens monthly.
Yeah, I think so. And I think our required reserve maybe went up a bit at one point. I don't think about it. I think some of this might actually have to do with the rec monies being over there too. So that could be part of it. The next item is this restricted cash. We actually had a pretty nice increase here. So to answer the question, Brian's question earlier, we need to kind of make a decision on how we want to fund those AMI meters in the future. We do have a pretty healthy amount of depreciation funds, which can be used for those new meters. We also can go out to bond. We are given the opportunity to go out and get debt every year. So we have options there.
And that option to go out and bond is the 2017 vote for $3.5 million.
Correct.
Okay. I just really wanted to quickly point out that our debt went down quite a bit, so it's good to be paying that off. I think that is it for this page. The next page Sure.
Because down at the bottom, the unrestricted, that net position, yeah. That's really where we have some reductions too. That just, so from 6.2 million down to 3.2 million. that's really a significant drop, right? It's like a
and that is kind of directly correlated with our cash balance that you see from above.
Okay.
And we'll see the reason for that in just a minute.
Okay.
That big drop. On the for-profit side, this is what you'd call your income statement. The big ones that we're going to talk about, and I'll show a slide here in a second, are these electric sales and then purchase power. That's really where we make our surplus and deficit every year. And I'll just go down to the bottom and show you in 2020, we had a deficit of 1.9 million. We projected a deficit, I think a little under a million for this year. And it ended up being quite a bit more than we expected. And I will talk about Laura provided me with some data on the historical degree days. The top line is the average for this data set. And then the second line is 2020. We were well under average for the last, 14 years for degree days. And that really drives our business. When we have hotter summers and colder winters, we are able to make more surplus. And another thing that plays into that is where our rates were set at. We were at the end of the life cycle of our previous cost of service study. And so this is highlighting that we really needed to do a cost of service study, which was just completed last year. So I think our rates are where they should be now, and we will start seeing a more healthy return.
This is also why we are moving to higher fixed fees, is to ensure that weather has less of an effect on our balance sheets.
Well, yes. It's also to cover our fixed cost, right?
So. Yeah, so that's why the sales volume matters so much, is because if we have mild summer and winter, we underestimate our collections, thus our fixed costs stay the same.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Laura and I have been working on, or I should say Laura's been working on calculating the what our true fixed cost is that we would like to, kind of match with that fixed fee, if that's the route that you guys wanted to go. I had another slide here that I just wanted to so you had a visual of kind of the margin between our power revenue and expense. You'll see from 2017 to 2018, they kind of tracked together. In 2019, they widened, which gave us a little bit more of a, we had a deficit that year, but it wasn't that as much as it could have been. And then 2020, you see that margin kind of thinning. So that's really what drove that loss in 2020.
And when you say expense, is that just the power supply expense, or is that all fixed expenses and everything?
Energy transmission distribution.
So it's just power purchase. Excuse me, it's just power purchase.
Okay, just power purchase.
Thank you, Laura.
Matt, can you, in here, the salaries and benefits went up fairly substantially between 19 and 20. And Dave, maybe you remember this. Was that accounted for by new FTEs that were approved, or did we do any reclassification of expenses for any reason?
No, it was new hires, new positions.
Oh, new hires. Yep.
Well, so yes. This was the first thing I looked at when I saw that our loss was so great is what if this was salary and personnel driven. And when I compared the total comp from 2019 to 2020, I think total comp only went up around 100,000. So this number is kind of deceiving. We had talked about this during the budget process, is that number is high because of we were only working every other day during COVID. And those every days that we were off are now going to this salaries and benefits category. Whereas they would have been hitting these distribution, transmission, and customer account categories. So there really wasn't a whole lot of fluctuation as far as personnel costs in this year.
Yeah, just one full-time employee.
Okay. So that just seemed that
maybe the other effect. Oh, sorry.
No, I was going to say that just sounded confusing. So if you've got FTE expense just because of COVID, it would otherwise be accounted for in a different category.
Yeah, I didn't
get allocating the salary to distribution and transmission, and that doesn't make sense.
So all labor gets put into different FERC accounts, and
okay,
you know, with the line workers on an okay schedule, their time was not getting put into normal categories. That's what Matt's saying. So it was getting put into the general salary category. So that's why it went up.
Okay, so you do allocate salary costs to those other line items generally. Yeah. Interesting. Yes.
I think
so. If we're working on.
No, never mind. Go right ahead. Go right ahead.
If one of the guys is out working on, let's say, the main station, his time's going to go to this transmission line category, and with the line guys kind of sitting at home every other day, though all those costs are now sitting in the admin category. This salaries and benefits is a little bit of a misnomer. This should probably just be administrative costs here. So the other thing I wanted to point out that also affected our bottom line this year is this third line item here, which is we say rate refund, which is a combination of the rate stabilization and the rate refund. We always talk about it in depth every year. It's the rate refund is the difference in the cost. Well, whatever we budgeted for our power in rates, let me start over. we charge a certain amount in our rates that is for the cost of energy. If that energy comes in below or above, we then have to either give back those dollars or take away from the customers. So we kind of remain net neutral. In this year, we had a large negative revenue essentially that drove down our bottom line. So
power, another way to say that, Matt, is power for 2020 ended up costing us less than what we thought it would. And when that happens, it doesn't become a net benefit to our bottom line because we are obligated to make power expense revenue neutral. If power ends up costing us less, we debit ourselves. We give that money directly back to the customers. So yep, we create a liability. We owe it back to the yep customers. And that's what one of the things that happened in 2020 is that power ended up costing less than we expected. And so we increased our liability, which, you know, helped reduce the net income.
Wendy, Alice has a question.
Oh, sorry. Thanks, Alice. Thanks, Brian. Alice, sorry.
I was just getting the sentence. Thank you for the clarification. I think that really helped, Laura. So what I want to understand is what is going back to the conversation about how we categorize our salaried employees. Is there a benefit to us in actually charging our salaries to these various accounts? Or are we really looking at salaries as salaries, no matter where the employees are working? I'm trying to understand why it's so variable in understanding what our salary costs are, depending on, I can understand line item budgeting, but line item salary should still total the same amount of salary dollars, no matter which account it's charged to. Did I say that okay?
Yeah, I understand. So we're required by FERC to put our dollars in, and it's basically a function of our DPU report. We're required to report the function of each dollar that's spent. I think what I really should do is have the auditors change this from salaries and benefits to a different, this is very misleading because there's a lot, there's different costs that hit this line item. But as far as these other costs down here, these are a direct function of what the activity that was done. You know, each dollar was done on just like, for example, the distribution system. So it's quite a bit different than what you would see normally on a for-profit financial statement where there is a salary line item. We're required to kind of adjust our buckets based on the FERC reporting.
And does that help actually with our cost of service study so that we can allocate the cost of that distribution more accurately?
All of these numbers were taken into a lot more detail than what you see here, but they were categorized by these same categories, and those are very, I think, pretty crucial to how they divvied up the dollars in the cost of service study.
So yes, Wendy, that does help actually, because dollars that are allocated to specific accounts like distribution and transmission are allocated to the customer classes according to a certain methodology, such as, you know, peak demand. When did your peak occur versus the entire utility? Whereas very general categories like salaries and benefits that cannot be allocated according to usage statistics, like peak demand, are allocated according to a more general allocator, which is sort of an amalgamation of all the allocators. I mean, it's kind of difficult to explain, but it's a melange, you know? And so the more specific we can be about where our costs, where the benefits of our costs reside, like did somebody's time, you know, positively impact the distribution system or the transmission system, that does help with the cost of service study. So you're right about that.
So I can understand why we do it. So the question is, are we, I think Matt alluded to this, whether we have a category at all of salary and benefits, since that doesn't seem to be related to salaries per se, per individual FTE, since we do this line item accounting for every cost that we charge to these other accounts, which I understand why we need them for the cost of service study, but then the salaries line item is an anomaly in the way we present our table here, right?
So I'm planning on at the next meeting presenting kind of an interim financial statement for you guys, and I will kind of highlight that in that presentation, and kind of I'll show you all the details that make up that category, and then I think it'll shed a little bit more light on what goes into that.
Okay.
Also, I'm planning on adding for the next budget cycle the more transparency as far as what our personnel costs are, so you can see apples to apples, and you're not looking at these buckets. I think it'll make a lot more sense if we do that.
Okay.
So, I guess if you don't mind, we could put it on hold till next meeting.
Yep. No, I think that would be helpful, at least for me. Thank you.
Yep. And I think we see a whole bunch more of this detail when it comes to the budget timeframe too. So
yeah,
we'll see it again. All right, Matt, how do you want to keep going? I don't know if you've covered everything. We're just a time check. We're running a little late, so.
Okay. That's the end of it. There's also the statement of cash flows. I'm not going to go over anything here. If you know how to read one of these, have fun.
And if you have questions, you can always reach out.
Yes.
Great. Well, thank you, Matt. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. So then we're staying right on time. 2 minutes late. That's it. So, Dave, we're going to move now on to the Energy New England presentation. And I think maybe you want to do an introduction for the folks who are here.
Yeah, let me just.
Oh, and Gordon's here. Sorry. Welcome, Gordon. All right. So Dave, while you're doing that, I'm just going to comment. Gordon, Alice was picking up the clerk duties for the beginning of the meeting. Will you take over from here?
I would be happy to continue.
Okay. Yeah, just
for continuity.
Okay.
All right. So we have.
Thanks.
Is this everyone, John?
I believe so. Yes. Marcos, Tim, and Jesse's on. Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'm going to kick this off, kick it over to John. John Zimmerangas is the president and CEO of ENA, and they're going to do a little presentation.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Wood. And thank you, members of the board, for having us. We're very pleased to present. I think it's probably been a couple of years since I've been up there, so I haven't met some of the newer members. Brian, I do know. Hi, Brian, going to some of the meetings. But we wanted to give an overview, kind of where the energy market is and where it's going, to give the board a flavor of what's going on out there in the industry itself. There's also some significant Concord-specific information in this presentation that we will go over, because obviously that's of great interest to you folks. It took us 4 years, and E&E, you know, with Dave and the other board members, had a lot to do with getting the climate bill section for MLPs completed this past year. Our governor signed it at the end of March. It does set at least a roadmap and a guideline for the MLPs, which didn't exist before, that basically mirrors the state goals. 50% by 2030, 75% by 2040, and net zero, obviously, by 2050. That's kind of the overall goals, but it does give us kind of that runway to be able to start to structure people's portfolio in that direction, and then obviously take input from each of the MLPs on how they want to do it. So you'll see some of that in this as well. And then obviously this is just the beginning of a conversation that we'll clearly have with Dave and with Laura going forward, and then with what the board policies are. Dave sent over some stuff today that I think we'll also be taking a look at and kind of work with you folks on where you want to go. So with that, I think I'm going to kick it over to Tim real quick, and then we'll get into the meat of the presentation.
Okay. And, you know, for Dave and the board, totally up to you folks. I know we talked about providing our thoughts here and doing questions at the end. If you want to do it along the way, feel free to jump in how you folks usually handle this. But I guess just picking up on what John said, power supply management has evolved quite a bit over the last 5 to 10 years with a number of light plants really moving towards decarbonization with haste. That's certainly a big part of what we do with you folks. And we've got a little bit that we put in here as well to kind of just talk about how the underlying power market is still out there and holds some risk. So there's a, you know, we're kind of in this hybrid time now of, you know, morphing from traditional power supply management and cost management into a, you know, more fully decarbonized or renewable supply portfolio. And that kind of brings different risks and thought processes with it. And so what we put together is kind of something that speaks to both. And a lot of the activity that that we're doing for you folks now, and a little bit of what we see kind of coming down the pike, as it were, for, you know, some thoughts, things to be considered as we go forward. We started probably in earnest in around 2010, where we would put together a kind of aggregated green transaction for whatever Energy New England customers chose to participate, be it hydro, wind, solar, et cetera. And we were probably doing about one of those transactions every other year. And in the last couple of years, we put 4 or 5 together. So I think that just kind of speaks to the pace is really picking up across our customer base. We've got about a couple of dozen public power entities that we help manage their supplies for. And, you know, there's a bit of a range, right? There's a grouping that wants to decarbonize sooner than later. There's kind of the other end of the spectrum that maybe doesn't get a lot of local pressure. And then there's a group in the middle. So, you know, we kind of try to look for opportunities that can fit any number of interest levels. And I think part of what we're speaking to here, you know, we can certainly see going forward with the roadmap 2050 coming into play, that there's going to be different interest levels, and we'll still be looking at aggregated transactions. but we expect to see more of our customer base doing some things together, but also focusing on their individual goals or town goals, et cetera. So with that,
Tim, I wonder, could I ask you perhaps to step back for a couple members of the board that might be less familiar with the NE to a higher elevation foot level and talk just for a couple seconds about what E&E, the services that it provides to CMLP and what your role is? Because I think maybe some people may not be as
familiar. Oh, sure, absolutely. Starting in the late 2000s, as CMLP was coming out of its last full requirements contract, kind of hearkening back to the pre-deregulation era, that happened to occur at a time when market power prices were really volatile, and how public power entities manage their wholesale costs was changing quite a bit. E&E was put together in 1998, really in response to wholesale energy deregulation in Massachusetts and throughout New England. So we got our beginnings in October of 98, or the summer of 98. And, I think the risk management piece really kind of came into its own in the mid 2000s when we started to have a lot of cost volatility. And we used to have a system that had relatively stable and low cost for energy. And that started to really change in earnest about 2004, 2005, thereabouts. At the time, as I said, CMLP had a contract that went through 2007 or 8. And about at that time, probably about a half a dozen municipal light plants throughout Massachusetts had what used to be called full requirements contracts that were rolling off at the time and kind of entering this new higher priced, kind of higher variable cost, lower fixed cost environment. What we used to have was much higher fixed cost and much lower variable cost. You were kind of beholden to what, an Eversource or a New England Power back in the day, I'm really dating myself there with that one, would offer for kind of a slice of the portfolio they had put together. You didn't have a lot of choice. So the good news is choice has increased, but risks changed too. And in the early 2000s, you folks were insulated from it, but there were a number of parties that came in. They may have built natural gas plants or set up energy trading shops. And a number of them, Enron's the famous one, but there were a bunch of others that went bankrupt or had credit events. So risk and credit management really became kind of a thing in the late 90s, early 2000s. So fast forward to that contract rolling off in the late 2000s, in a much different market environment. That's really when Energy New England started working with CMLP to manage its power supply. At about the same time, we increased our ownership, and John, please feel free to jump in anytime. But that's when Concord came in along with Hingham and Wellesley as we expanded our ownership. So you are also.
Tim, to Tim's point, that's an important point too. While we do and have continued to do all the work Tim is talking about, as the market has changed, when the membership opened up, and I happened to be at that time at Hingham, Hingham became a member, as did Concord. And I think that relationship has been very positive going forward. But E&E tried to expand kind of its membership, bring in a few more people. And as that came in 2007, we also started to get and attract more customers that came off contracts like Tim talked about or others. And all of a sudden we went from just the five or six owners at the time, up to where, Tim's folks now have 24 systems that they manage their supply for. So, and just quickly to Laura's point, it's not just supply. I know that's what we're talking about tonight. We have a whole energy efficiency and electrification division. David mentioned the heat pump program and some EV things. We do those for several systems as well. So there's home energy audits and other things that go with energy efficiency that we're involved with Concord. And that's all kind of voluntary. Pam and Jan do a lot of work with us on that side of the house, along with Laura, obviously, with Tim's folks.
That's kind of, the residential conservation goes back to when it first started to be a requirement,
right,
about 20 years ago. So while the company was founded to do the risk management piece. It was certainly made a lot of sense, I think, for public power systems to kind of get together, kind of from a shared services or cost management perspective. And, you know, we've kind of grown that opportunistically over time. You folks mentioned the MLP solar program that came out through DOER. We've worked really hard through our E&E strategies, kind of lobbying and government affairs practice, to develop and really improve, enhance the relationships with the state, with MassDOER, et cetera. So for something like the MLP solar program, we play a role in helping kind of manage in between the light plants and the DOER and managing those funds when, you know, they happily were able to craft a...
I think we lost him.
Oh, he froze. Oh, there we go.
Froze. There you go. Yeah.
Oh, did I freeze?
Yeah, just for a second there.
I it was stellar. What I said was absolutely fantastic. So,
all right, we want to kick it over to Jesse. Is he?
Yeah. No, going? That's if that suffices, Laura. Sure. Yeah.
All right. Sounds good. Dave, are you sharing the presentation? I could share it too.
I can.
Okay.
So can you guys see it?
Yep.
Yeah, I can see that. Okay, so following up on, you know, what Tim and John said, I'm an analyst at E&E. You know, I do the power hedging, risk management, generation management for Concord. I've also worked with Laura and Dave on numerous renewable projects, you know, helping CMLP decarbonize their portfolio through PPAs, solar, wind, et cetera. So this slideshow is going to be a whole run through power markets. Bear with us, you know, there's a lot to it, but we'll try to summarize as best we can. And then we have a couple good graphs in here to help describe the points. So going along with what Tim said, we kind of want to describe that, the general decision points behind power and risk management. You know, between 2008 and 2021, what we've generally employed is, you know, laggard and staggered hedging with shape blocks, generally within a 5-year time frame. So looking at 2022, we're going to be trying to hedge them up to about 80%, and then just buying further out each year a little bit less. So it's kind of a staggered process, essentially dollar cost averaging through time as prices move up and down through each calendar year to really get exposure to lower prices, sometimes higher prices. But to do this, you know, every municipal utility has to have master buy and sell agreements. And CMLP has those agreements with all of the top suppliers. You know, we have Constellation, Dominion, EDF, NextEra. We could essentially go out to those counterparties at any time and purchase or sell power. One suggestion we might want to make is we might want to add BP as a counterparty. We find they've provided very generous parent guarantees for credit support, and they're also very active in markets and competitive. So that's one. CMLP has a good mix of suppliers, but we just thought it'd be good. You know, we're kind of looking at BP would be a good addition, we think. Some other points that we look at in procurement include supplier diversity, credit management, what is the strength of the counterparty, some are investment grade, some are not. So they'd have to put up additional credit like that parent guarantee. We look at delivery point, what products to buy. And then there's some other products we optimize. There's the HQ phase 1 and 2 use rights, which are essentially transmission rights that Concord has. They own a piece of transmission to help reduce that transmission charge on the bill. So we've done deals with counterparties to optimize those too. So there's numerous products we're optimizing. And as we've discussed, you know, with Roadmap 2050 and just the general trend in New England, we are increasingly decarbonizing. And that has been a large part of power procurement for Concord. So we're introducing growing contribution from intermittent long-term renewable contracts. And the difference is, you know, these are 20-year, 15 to 25-year contracts compared to a 1-year power, shape block power deal. So we're getting involved with long-term PPAs with renewables. Currently, Concord has a REC purchasing plan and to buy additional RECs on top of what they get from the renewables. So that's the general thought process. And if you could skip to the next slide, Dave. So here we, there's a lot of graphs here. I'll try to explain them as best I can, but we thought it'd be good to focus on, you know, a next potential transaction as a good hedging example. So we wanted to look at calendar year 2022. And right now Concord has 21 power contracts, but those are all mostly variable. So there's still pockets of exposure, particularly in the winter nights, which is defined as the off peak in power markets. So if you look at the graph at the top, we can see that in January and February, there's an open position for on peak, which is generally the daytime, of about 26%. But in those off peak times for January and February, Concord's almost 40% open. And that, what that means is, you know, absent any other hedging, on average, Concord's going to be buying from the spot market the hourly price for that portion of the portfolio. So, you know, we've been adding a lot of renewables. There's a lot of contracts on the book, but there's still risk, particularly in these winter months with an open position. You know, looking at the summer, you can see that there is a larger open position there. It's around, you know, let me see here. It's greater than 30%. But if you look at the graph at the bottom and the green bar, it may be tough to see, but you can see that that green bar and on the scale y-axis to the left, power in the summer is around going for $42 right now. You go out and buy your summer power for $40, $42, maybe $45. But then the, let's look at the winter bar there. It's trading up upwards of $120. So the winter, even though there's a similar open position in the summer, the risk is a lot less based on the forward power curve and also five-year historical pricing, which we'll get into on the next slide, kind of show you where prices have been. So one strategy we're thinking, you know, Concord generally targets around a 20% hedge baseline, meaning they're hedged up to 80% and then they buy 20% on the spot market. That's, you know, where your variable risk is. So, you know, given that there's a large portion of this risk is in the winter, you know, one suggestion is we could, you know, increase the hedge position in the winter to 90%, but then open it up a little bit in the summer and take more risk there because there's less volatility. So, you know, I know Concord's been employing a flat baseline. We could do a staggered approach monthly. Just one suggestion we did, and we also did some modeling behind that. We'll keep going from there. So if we go on to the next slide, Dave, that'd be great.
So Jesse, if I could just mention that we did have a similar open risk profile to the one you're just regarding for 2022 in 2021. And we did instigate spot transactions in order to mitigate that risk. We ended up executing, I believe, January, February, and maybe July, August transactions in order to decrease that open percentage that you show in the winter months and in the summer. I think we did it with PSEG.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, that'd be great. Let's, you know, we'll share those numbers and we'll take a look at that. So one of the risk ways we measure this risk, you know, in the winter, in the summer, wherever it is, you know, we looked at the historical five-year average volatility. And what we do is we use a software called OutRisk, and it runs a Monte Carlo simulation, 1,000 simulations based on historical pricing, you know, where's the risk in the portfolio? And you can see in the bottom two graphs, you know, just like the one we saw earlier, most of it is in the winter based on these simulations. If you look, it takes about 22% of Concord's risk is in the months of January and February based on our simulations. So just to show some of the risk management tools we're using to quantify that risk. And we can move on, Dave. Thank you. So this slide kind of describes, you know, Concord has a lot of resources it's buying from, but most of those resources aren't actually in the same zone that Concord is located in. So we kind of wanted to describe the locational aspect of where is Concord's load and where its resources are. Essentially, Concord buys all of its load in the NEMA zone, which is essentially Boston, Northeast Massachusetts, but the revenue it receives from its resources for their generation is in other zones. So what we've seen is that based on the pricing dynamics in NEMA, you know, Boston tends to be the most expensive zone. So the revenue that it receives from its wind resources, its solar, its hydro located in other parts of New England, it's not a one-to-one offset versus what it's paying for load So one of the good things is much of the contract exposure is to the Mass Hub, and that's that big orange portion of the pie graph. And the Mass Hub is like a zonal average for all of Massachusetts. And the good thing is that contracting at the Mass Hub is often closely priced to NEMA. It's about less than 1%. And generally when we do renewable contracts, we try to price them at the Mass Hub to put that spread risk on the developer. The largest discrepancy you can see is the NYPA hydro generation that comes from New York. So when that generation comes into New England, it's worth about 6-7% less than what Concord's paying at the NEMA load. So we just wanted to highlight this and show, you know, one of the important parts of green contract, green resource contracting is one, valuing where the generation is located, when it's producing, what hours, what's its shape, and then what it's worth. So we really try to mitigate some of that spread risk that we see here to settling these renewable or any project outside of Massachusetts at the Mass Hub.
So Jesse, I feel like maybe for some people who might not be following your very erudite explanation, we might need to dumb this down a little bit further to explain that, you know, the ISO New England works like a big bank. Okay, you put energy in at a certain location on the grid and you take it back out at a certain location. CMLP is in Northeastern Massachusetts. So we are always taking energy out to give to our load in Northeastern Massachusetts. That's the most expensive place to buy energy. Many of our resources are located in less expensive regions like Maine, where there's lots of wind, okay? So when we give energy to the ISO New England in Maine, they give us a credit, okay, for energy that's worth less than the amount we've got to pay to take it back out in Northeastern Massachusetts. So it's like a big banking game, but there's lots of dollars at risk, which is what Jesse's describing. And what he's saying is he's trying to manage what they call the basis risk, the difference between, you know, your credits and your debits and where they're located. And that's an important part of risk management, along with, you know, the tenor of the contracts, who your counterparty is with. This is an important component.
Yep, exactly right. Thank you, Laura.
Do you mind if I ask a quick question, Wendy?
Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, Brian.
So I love the level of detail. Laura knows I'm a nerd on this. this is great. And this is one of the hopes I have going forward is that we can find renewable contracts closer to home to avoid this risk. And this is a great breakdown of what that risk is. I know that building things here is more expensive than in Maine. And thus we've done a great job of putting, you know, wind in Maine and taking this risk, but we need to diversify where the risk is and more projects closer within the NEMA territory, preferably, or within town would be wonderful. Just a comment.
From our perspective, just the thoughts about that, to your point, you know, Maine is kind of where you could get the onshore wind built, right? And that's why the projects are up there. I think, you know, totally hear that. And when we take a look at renewable opportunities, we're looking at the intermittent nature of the production, right? How when the projects produce energy. And here we're talking about where they produce it. And kind of with that in mind, it's really hard to build wind in Southern New England. Solar is a little bit different. Northeast Mass, Eastern Mass generally is really challenging because of land prices. Mm-hmm. But looking at the last couple of transactions we've tried to put in place, the First Light hydro transactions, facilities on the Connecticut River, right on top of Mass Hub, much less of a difference in price with where you folks are located and where the plants are located. Chariot Solar is not operating yet. That project is a 50 megawatt solar project that you're part of. That's going to be in southwestern New Hampshire. Gravel Pit Solar, also to be built. You folks are part of that. That's going to be along the Connecticut Valley Corridor, transmission corridor, with some of that project being in kind of western Massachusetts and some in northwestern Connecticut. Again, thought process being not only was the project an attractive price, but also in a little bit better location. But there are certainly some limitations that are a little bit tough to get over, particularly in Eastern Massachusetts, really partly due to what can get built and what it costs to do so.
Do you have energy developers approaching you saying, I'd really love to build a project, I just need a location to build it? Is it connecting landowners to these entities that can build these facilities?
That was probably more the case when the Massachusetts Solar Rec program started, probably about 2010. Brian, we more likely will be approached by a developer that kind of has, even if the project's early stage, they'll typically have, if they don't have land control, they're working on it. So more often than not nowadays, they've got the whole kind of package already kind of coming together.
Okay. Thanks.
Mm-hmm.
I'll let Jesse pick up on his slideshow. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. No, that's a great question. Thanks. All right, we're good to go to the next slide, Dave. All right, so you know, here we wanted to show that Concord's done a great job decarbonizing its portfolio of green resources. So we really created an annual chart that breaks up the portfolio by fuel type. And you know, Tim mentioned the gravel pit solar deal, Chariot solar deal, all these solar projects that are coming online around 2024, 2025. That Concord's participating in. So when we get come 2025, we can see that just from renewable contracts alone, Concord will be about 66% carbon free. And that's based on our expected average generation, but it's still quite high. You know, based on our estimates, you'll have about 13% wind generation, 11% solar, about a 30% nuclear portfolio, and about 12% hydro. So there's a good mix of projects in there to get you to that 66%. And then on top of that, you know, the remaining power supply is decarbonized through Concord's REC purchasing program. So that's the main point of that. Brian, you have another question?
You had said the terms non-emitting and renewable. I wanna just make sure we're clear on that. You had said non-emitting for about 60%. I'm sorry, I don't remember the exact percentage, but a good half of that is the nuclear Seabrook contracts. Is that correct?
Correct. Yeah. So we're going along the lines of, you know, and this is always a debate, is non-emitting, carbon-free, renewable. How is it defined? And I think the Roadmap 2050 bill that the Senate passed, we're going along those guidelines, and they define these renewable resources as carbon-free. And they're including the nuclear in that, the hydro in that, the wind and the solar. So we're really using that carbon-free definition based on the Roadmap 2050 guidelines.
Yeah, it would be helpful for us to know the percentage of renewable with the REC retired, because I know under that roadmap that non-emitting is considered half the emissions of a dual cycle natural gas plant in the legislation. So it's not really zero. So it would be good to know the difference between non-emitting and renewable when we talk about the portfolio, and renewable referring to the retired RECs.
Well, I think, if I may, I think that comparison to the natural gas combined cycle is really targeted towards biomass qualifying. What we try to do kind of conceptually is, as Jesse said, we try to look for resources that meet the definitions for non-carbon emitting in the Roadmap 2050 legislation, and then also focused on similarly resources that also qualify per the Mass DEP reporting, the AQ 31 and 32 reports that light plants provide, which kind of narrows the field a little bit. But if I'm not mistaken, I think that combined cycle comparison is largely for biomass. And admittedly, public power gets a little bit broader definition in the Roadmap 2050 legislation. So that's kind of where we start, but then, you know, kind of where we end up is always a function of, you know, then within that each light plant can be a little bit different.
Yeah, and it's that little bit different that I think Concord has made clear that we want to go with the stricter definitions rather than the looser ones in that roadmap.
Sure.
Yeah, Brian, the other thing is in the roadmap, we've committed to anything. And when I say we, I'm not talking about E&E, I'm talking about the MLPs, you know, when they all got together, that the RECs will be retired, you know, after 2030. So any project you have, you know what I mean? Because some people today, you know, retire some, sell some, you know, to get where they want to be. So part of us being able to get that even passed was a requirement to retire the RECs associated with the projects going forward.
Yeah. And a compliment here. I really want to compliment E&E on the REC retirement, because I know MWAC, many of them are still saying they're giving lower prices to their customers through sale of the RECs. And we've had that debate here in town and so forth. So I'm appreciative that I've seen other E&E MLPs taking more of a Concord line on that issue rather than some other MLPs by MWAC. So thank
you. And that's the tact we've taken with everybody. Again, you know, understanding that everybody has a choice. I mean, that's the whole local control and all that. But in the big picture, when we were going through the legislation and when Chairman Golden was good enough to champion it, and I'll be honest with you, a chairman of a committee typically does not file legislation, but he did, and that helps us get it through. And you know, I give him a big thanks. Been a good friend for a long time, but that was part of the requirement, and that's okay because that's where everybody's headed.
Yep.
You know, so we're kind of foolish, right, if we don't get on that train.
Yeah, I'm glad they removed the double counting.
Yeah, that was easy to do, right? I mean, yep. Let's be honest, that was simple.
Right. I'll let you get back to the presentation.
Yeah, sorry about that. I jumped in too. Sorry, Jess.
Oh, no worries. It's a good conversation. Kind of pivots well to this slide. You know, we kind of wanted to take a look of what's already happened in 2021. And yeah, they are the EFACs, those emission-free energy credits, those are coming from your NYPA and your CBREC piece. And we're retiring those. We're receiving class one RECs, class two RECs from the hydro generators, class one from the wind and solar generators. So we really just wanted to show, you know, where those RECs are coming from. But then on top of that, with the Concord REC purchasing program, E&E is going out and securing another 10,000 class one RECs. So we're reaching out to counterparties, negotiating them for the best price and essentially getting those RECs for Concord. So in 2021, we bought about 10,000 RECs, class one RECs on Concord's behalf.
Yeah. And it's great that the unbundled purchases are supporting the class one RECs in Massachusetts and not being spread across many different kind of credits.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think we're good there. So pivoting off the RECs, we thought we just want to show where Concord stands relative to Roadmap 2050. That was signed by the governor on March 26. We've already discussed it, but 100% by 2050. The first step up is 50% by 2030. So we could already see that Concord's ahead of the game and above that 50% threshold just on the RECs received from project entitlements alone. We're not counting any purchase RECs here. This is just a forecast of what Concord will receive from its contracts. So you can see you get up to about 60-65% come 2025, but we do have a couple of contracts falling off come 2030. So there is just discussion underway really to extend those renewable projects. And this is a situation a lot of systems are in just based on the nature of the contracts. So we're doing a good job getting above 50% already, but we just want to make sure that we're keeping our portfolio there already. And, you know, we do have the REC purchasing program. So, you know, based in that fourth bullet, we looked at, we project that you'll purchase an additional 40,000 to 80,000 RECs a year, depending on price. So this is just to show where you stand against the requirement, and it's in a good spot. We'll just have to keep an eye on those contracts rolling off while we continue to add new resources. So we just kind of wanted to summarize, you know, what are the two main, of the many focuses, but what we're really focusing on now is commodity price risk. We have our traditional gas and power risk, We're hedging that through blocks and load follow contracts. And we're going to continue that commodity hedging with really, it's going to decline over time as we add more renewables. Right now, the main idea is, you know, a larger open position on the spot market that allows for the opportunity of potentially higher or lower prices. So it's increased risk. So any open position on the spot market in general gas and power, you'll need to have cash on hand to withstand any price spike. So it's a question of, you know, are there greater incentives to the risk to potentially save money or to lock in rate and no budget? So that's just a summary of the power market. And we can see, just like all other commodities, power prices are really on the rise, similar to natural gas, oil. Really, since COVID-19, March of 2020, we saw a bottom in all commodities, and we are seeing power prices on the rise. So we are going to start to focus on our hedging, which we'll work with Dave and Laura with on a good strategy there. And then we'll continue to add carbon-free resources. The graph on the right kind of shows the path of REC prices over the past few years. So you can see that, you know, RECs can be volatile. You know, class one RECs in Massachusetts have been anywhere from $18 to $43 a REC. And one important thing to note is in 2020, the price of a class one REC was worth more than power. So the renewable attribute was worth more than the power itself. It's come off a little bit more, but it's just another risk dynamic that we need to take into account, considering Concord is going out and buying these RECs. And another point to note is, you know, we will continue to buy RECs, but buying from specific projects is a good hedge against that REC price volatility. You know, you're paying for the energy in the RECs from a specific project at a certain price, so you know what your REC price is. So we just wanted to highlight that, you know, there is volatility in those RECs that we'll have to keep an eye on.
That's great. Can I ask a quick question about where the data for the pricing of a class one REC is coming from? Are you collecting that from the buying and selling, or is that an aggregate of the market?
Yeah, it's an aggregate of the broker market.
Okay. And it's great because you mentioned about the volatility in RECs. We have in our plan that we will collect a certain amount of money and then apply RECs, and that removes the threat of rate shock to our customers. And we really appreciate your work on that, making those RECs as affordable, but still their point is to have value and supporting more development of renewables. So higher is it better in that sense, but we also do want to offset the most we can, and that means lower is better. So it's that dynamic. Thank you for the help with that.
And Jesse, I'm just going to jump in for a sec. I'm doing a time check.
Sure.
I don't know how many slides you have left, but I'll ask people to hold their comments if they can, and we get through the presentation.
Yeah, we're finishing up. We're on the last two slides, right. I believe. So I'll run through quickly. We kind of described, you know, where we were, where we are. One important point we just want to focus on quickly is, as we add more of these renewable resources, it's going to unbalance the portfolio. And you can see on the graph at the bottom that there's already times where we project that in the spring months, in the on-peak period, when the solar is high, the wind is high, and the hydro is high, there's going to be times when Concord's receiving more power than it needs and selling back to the market. So we're going to want to start looking at ways to optimize that and reduce that variability. And one good example was the NextEra Solar and Seabrook deal. What Concord has about 2.3 megs from there. And what we did is we took a solar shape and we firmed nuclear output around it to create a predictable block shape. So it's just one example of the opportunities or ways in the market to firm up renewables. There's going to be talks. We're going to look at battery storage. We've already worked with some suppliers to sell back some wind energy and then do some balancing products. So just want to focus on where we think the future is heading here and what we're trying to do already.
Great.
And then we could go to the last slide. So the next steps, really kind of work with Dave and Laura, redefine the risk management and hedging policy and incorporate the green needs of the Concord community and Light Board in terms of where they want to be. We're looking at, currently we have term sheets from hydro generators, solar generators, onshore wind. We're looking at numerous resources, class one, class two. And we could do group aggregate purchases, individual purchases. So we're looking at a lot of renewable options right now that we'll be bringing out shortly, continue raising that non-carbon percentage, and then looking out in the future, balancing cost and that intermittent production. So that is our quick, brief, but hopefully helpful run through the power market and the Concord portfolio.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you very much. There's a lot of detail in those slides that I can barely read. But Dave, I assume that you'll distribute that presentation.
I will.
Forward, so we'll have that. That's great.
It's a little easier when you can zoom in on some of the graphs.
Yeah, so. I'm sure. Yeah, very helpful, as always. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. So we're back on time again. So moving on in our agenda, we're moving on to the broadband update. Dave, do you want to?
Yep. Greg just got on.
Okay.
Thank you all for coming and presenting. It was very helpful.
Yeah, very much so.
Dave, I think I saw that Pam Hill is on as a participant. Could we promote her to a panelist?
Oh.
Yep, just give me a minute.
Thanks. And actually, what I recall is that Pam had to leave at 8, so I don't know if she's chiming in to say she's got to leave. Thanks, Gordon, for identifying that.
Okay.
I'm not leaving. I had the wrong day. I'm really.
Oh, all right. All right.
That was tomorrow. I'm good for a long time.
Okay, and good.
I look at the recording of the presentation, the part of which I missed. I'm very sorry.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's the recordings are great. All right.
Okay.
Thank you. All right.
All right. So, Greg's going to give an update on broadband, and I'm just going to let him take it away.
Good evening. So I think when we left, we wanted to really just look at the whole, the past, obviously, and what we really feel we need to do in the future to bring broadband up to speed, up to today's speed. The network, the way it was designed and where it was fine. We definitely found some issues and some of the technologies and how they just, probably some maintenance, minor maintenance stuff and things like that. So what we have done is we met with a number of vendors, as we mentioned, a third-party vendor, just looking at the network design in general. And then we met with the individual major players, Calix, Cisco reps, and just to look at equipment we could use. So we basically came back with 9 items in our priority list that we think we want to move ahead with in the very near future. On some of them, we highlighted some as high, medium, and low risk with the network. And I just wanted to give an update where we are now with that. So we met with Calix. So for those who, just to know, there's basically 2 main designs with the broadband, but Calix is really the equipment that is broadband on a pure level. So that is the equipment that all the residents are attached to, that routes out to the internet. It's the horsepower. It's basically the horsepower behind the broadband network. And then we have a core network design that we are, supports the overall broadband distribution throughout the town. So the Calix switches, we met with Calix, had a thorough review with them, and we basically come back with a couple minor changes, and one was just we have a called a primary switch without giving out the entire design, but it's a primary switch. We saw that switch. We knew from looking at the review that if that switch goes down, we would have a network-wide outage, and that switch would have to be reconfigured or replaced, whatever the case may be. So there were backups in our already in the design, just waiting to replace a switch if there was an outage. And we decided that we would take one of those backup switches and we would clone that primary switch so that and rack it right next to the this primary switch so that if we did have that switch crash, we would reduce the outage time from probably 2 to 3 hours to 60 minutes or less, depending on if it happened at midnight or if it happened during the day. It happens during the day, we can be over there in minutes and make the swap. And if it happened, obviously in the evening, our on-call technicians and network engineers would come in to replace it. So that might take up to an hour by the time we get to the location. But it has been, it's actually should be completed this week. I believe we met with Calix yesterday. I'm on vacation, by the way, just so that's why I'm not quite detailed on with the network engineer, but we were supposed to meet with Calix yesterday or this morning. And so I'll look for update on that, but that should be completed this week. And that was one of our high priorities to get this configuration completed so that we would definitely reduce any kind of major outage for network-wide outage. We're looking at the core switches and routers. We're placing them under maintenance. Some maintenance has lapsed on those, and that is also a high priority. We have received two vendor quotes and we'll have a third. So we're looking to place those under maintenance for switch replacement and support, probably within, I'd say by the end of next week at the latest.
And so, Greg, when you say put it on support, does that mean if it crashes, they're going to be on site and replacing that equipment ASAP?
Yes, and it depends what this situation would be, because it could be a configuration issue. Yep. But typically in this case, it would be a switch. It would be probably a hardware failure. And we do have redundancy built in for that. So, it would be more that we would be under maintenance, under support. We'd have an engineer support us during the replacement and repair, reconfiguration, et cetera. So that would be the case. We are also want to test the redundancy on the network. I don't know that it's ever been tested, and it's something that should be on a normal basis. We are going to be putting a maintenance schedule together and testing the redundancy on the core network and failover on the Calix side. We're going to put together a program to test that on a regular basis. And basically testing it is basically literally pulling the switch on one device and see if it fails over properly to the second device or its redundant counterpart. So we're probably going to do that. We're going to have to schedule an outage with the town. It'll be a planned outage. Then we will probably do it probably like in the wee hours of a Sunday morning is probably the most likely candidate. So probably 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And again, with a test like this, it's, you know, very little risk that they'll, you know, if the redundant switch doesn't automatically take over, almost always these can be forced to take over. So even we just like to know if it's gonna be an automatic or not. But if it doesn't, we would have the ability to force the second switch to take over, or router, whichever the case may be. Our fourth is we are going to have Calix come in and do a pro services assessment. They're already sent us a quote on it. We're just going to get hours with Calix and use them. We'll just be able to use the hours as needed. Probably start with as simple as 10 hours, but they're going to come in and just help us look at the switches. We know there's just information in them that is no longer being used, and that's common in a lot of networks. So we've really felt that we want to have them come in. We'll have them give us an assessment and then we'll proceed with that. And it's basically cleaning up the switches, just so there's no ancillary information, configurations, classes of service, et cetera, you know, doing nothing. But again, it's not a critical issue. So we have that as a low priority because it's not something that is affecting the network in any way. It is really more of a operations piece that just makes it easier for us to look at things, for technicians not to be confused when they're setting up services for clients, et cetera. So we're gonna get them down to where they should be. And then so it'd be just less confusion. We are also looking at one of the issues we feel is just on a general, it's kind of 5 and 6 are the same item. And that is that the DHCP servers, which we did have a problem with for the outage, are on a virtual network. And we're looking at how we can separate the dependencies between the town network and the broadband network. So we are in a process of looking at new appliances that will be actually locally deployed where the network is, opposed to going across and depending on a connection in another building or another hop and another environment, that if there's any issues with that environment, it could cause problems with the broadband side. So by relocating these DHCP servers and putting them closer, actually literally homing them where the Calix equipment exists, we'd have a lot less chance of having any issues and running into some of the problems that we did run into during the outage. And that was connectivity. So number 6 is broadband town network dependencies again. So those things are almost, you know, number 5 is an item of number 6, is one of the things we looked at, and we're going to try to just separate the town network from the broadband network as much as possible. So there's very little dependencies and only the required dependencies between what the town uses on the core of what's running the broadband network that, you know, we'll continue to support. But this will allow us to just eliminate any other quirks and kinks and things that could exist that we're not aware of. And so if the town network starts having any kind of squirreliness in it, it will not affect the broadband network at all. We're putting that as a medium priority, and we're in the process of working with Jason Bolger, CIO, and identifying those, and then we're gonna move forward as a team to, again, just reduce those dependencies. We are setting up a broadband monitoring, strictly broadband. Right now, most of the monitoring software applications, they monitor the entire network, broadband and town. And again, I think we're looking at where broadband is growing so much, it is really becoming its own entity in the sense of technology-wise, that we are going to purchase some software. We're in the 30-day trial with it right now. And we've authorized the PO that we're gonna be purchasing it. It's $2,400. So that we will have one application that will be only monitoring the broadband network. And it's much easier for us to get diagnoses and alerts and alarms. And instead of trying to figure out as things are coming in, because if things are happening on both networks, we can decipher much more quickly what is the problem and why we're having if we're having issues with the broadband network purely. We are also in the process, number 8, we're putting it at a medium level, and that's just redesigning the core basically for today. The core that's there today is a very functional core. It's working well, it's stable, but the 3 throughput on it, as we grow, we'll start to see its, you know, challenges possibly. So we're looking to redesign a core, come back to the board with a number and exactly what the design, what we want the design to look like, and the cost of doing that. And that will carry broadband probably for the next 7 to 8 years as technology. So just to give an example, our core today, again, very stable, doing the job it's doing and supporting the network as it is, but I would compare it to a Porsche and a Volkswagen. What we're redesigning is truly gonna have the throughput. There would never be any bottlenecks. There can never be any latency caused by the network itself. Like I said, the throughput is just night and day. And so we're gonna present that in the next meeting with the cost to the board and in our discussions internally as well. And then the last piece or the last item we have is the our ISP bandwidth. And we have a number of vendors, three, but there are two that we're primarily, we're gonna upgrade so that each one of those vendors, and that's coming along with cost. You know, previously, like all technology, costs are coming way down, and it's gonna allow us to basically have two redundant ISP providers, and they'll be, the new design will be, both providers will be in both redundant switch, in the switch of redundancy, built into the redundancy of the system, so that if any, even if we had an ISP outage, one of the, our ISPs literally had a 100% outage on their side, not likely, but if they did, it would not affect the performance of the broadband network. And so we're really looking at this is because, as I mentioned in a couple of meetings, I think broadband, you know, when this was all started, you know, everybody still had their Verizon telephones. People still probably had Comcast and, you know, their television, so whatever. And we weren't I don't think there was a dependency on broadband like it is today. Medical devices, smart houses, smart homes, whatever, and all that. So we learned that this was a, how much more people depend on the internet. And thus we're really looking to lift the broadband network up to that level that we can really obtain a 99.5% uptime, and that downtime should be planned, not accidental.
So Greg, did I hear you say that you plan to come back in our next meeting with more detail on the financial impact of this core as well as the ISP bandwidth?
That's correct.
Your plan. Okay.
Yeah. And I do have most of it done. I'd asked Dave if I could just present the next because of my leaving for vacation.
Yeah, no, and I think Dave and I had agreed that there'd be a more detailed plan. So it would be helpful. You went through this quickly. It was all verbal. If there was, if you could put together these 9 things in writing so the board just at least has that and we don't have to wait for the minutes to have that, that might be helpful.
Sure.
And I am sensitive to time, but does the board have any specific questions for Greg? Gordon? And you're on mute, Gordon.
I think I recall that during the outage, safety services communication was impacted. And I'm wondering if that's the case, aside from hardening and improving the system, is there any attention paid to making sure that our police department, fire department, and et cetera, are protected to the most reasonable level possible? Thanks.
Yes, so the actual safety services was a fiber break, that a connector actually that caused that for the towers to go down, and they came up pretty quickly. But we are looking into, we've just completed the project at the Middlesex School as well, which is also with the emergency services. And so we're going to be looking at how, we can make that more redundant as well.
Alice?
So I really appreciate hearing these 9 items on the priority list. Obviously, there are other items in the report that you presented at our last meeting that are not considered priority items, which include a plan for how we manage any extreme outage where we might have to put into play advanced communications systems. And I'm wondering if these are your first 9 priorities, and I think I appreciate Wendy's comment that we really would like to see these in writing. And from my perspective, I'd like to see it in a timeline so we know what's happening at what point. There are all these other items that are not considered priorities that may seem like greater priorities to our customers, like notification and communications and having a response plan in place that are not considered priorities on this list. So if we can address some of the items that looked like they were important to us, but and think about how that fits into our strategy for bringing the whole system up to snuff.
Yeah, and I apologize. I did not by any means want to downplay that. We are in the process. I'm almost completely done with the emergency response plan. And I'm just dotting the I's and crossing the T's right now. That has absolutely been a priority of ours. And I know in the last meeting, he had asked that there be a communications piece. That was always in and will be in that plan. And that's exactly what that is part of, depending on the type of outage, who's called and how it is elevated through each and every, you know, in the different types of outages we will be documenting.
Thank you.
So Greg, maybe in September when you're back, we can just touch base on those other aspects of the report. I know you were working on them and we didn't have time to cover all of them today. Yeah. So we'll have
absolutely
additional report in September. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so I think that's it for questions. I don't see other hands raised. We are almost out of time. I want to give a quick update. Moving on to the broadband committee charge, 2 updates. One is that there was a select board meeting yesterday, which I, unexpected reasons, could not attend the meeting. I do see the attendees. Terry is on the list as well as Matt Johnson. I'd asked Matt earlier to give a quick update on that discussion. You all received the charge that was drafted. The select board reviewed it and there's been some significant feedback on that and it's going to be modified. So I thought it would just be helpful to have Matt or Terry give an update. And I don't know, Terry, since you're here, do you want to give the update on the select board's feedback or feedback from the meeting last night?
Sure, I can give that feedback.
Great, thanks, Matt.
And in fact, Terry today issued a revised draft that she sent to Wendy. And so I think it could be distributed to the board. But I could just quickly review the changes that were made in that draft. So let me just bring it up on the screen share here.
Okay.
So really the only changes that were made were fundamentally reducing the length of the charge by cutting a lot of content that was giving background information that wasn't really relevant to the charge of the committee itself, but that could probably be included in the report that the task force eventually generates. So you can see here, really we cut a number of paragraphs of content and really just got to the 3 key points that the report will present without getting into the details of each of those topics the way that the original draft charge did. That it really is down to the content that was voted by town meeting. And then the only other change that is significant is that for the membership, that the 2 citizens at large, we did indicate that, you know, there should be a preference given to those with experience in the industry. Otherwise, you know, there a lot of the other details stay the same, such as we do expect that there will be a member chosen from the light board. Then we have other members as there, and that, you know, the goal of the committee in its first, or of the task force, is really to generate that report by February 1st. And so the term of office, it should be until February 1st, 2022. And there is the opportunity for us in the select board to extend that term if needed. We did have discussion in the board about the possibility that there could be kind of a successor to this task force, which would deal more with strategy and you know, the whole marketing and all kinds of other things. But really, when we looked at the very restricted timeframe that was presented in the petition article and voted by town meeting, it gave the select board less latitude to make changes in the charge than we normally would. And so we really had to stick with the language that was in the warrant article in many cases, and with the time frame that was established there. Okay. So that's the update.
Thanks, Matt. I very much appreciate your giving that update.
Okay. And Wendy, if I could just add,
Terry,
I sent you late today.
Yep.
The document you were just looking at with both two versions, the track changes and the clean copy. So you should have it now.
Yeah, and I will distribute it to the board. I wanted to have this discussion first and get your permission. So thank you, appreciate that. And it will be discussed again at next week's select board meeting, correct? Right.
Right. Yeah, and that means that there's a very tight timeline to get responses.
Right. Well, yeah. We're hoping to finalize it next Monday night if we can.
Yeah. Well, you have received via last month everyone's feedback on the charge. And literally what I saw you do is cut out a bunch of text from the charge. So I don't know if we're going to be adding more or not. So I think your intention is to keep it brief. So I don't expect there'll be more. So, okay, so we are over time, but I actually do want to see if there are board members who would be willing to participate on the committee once the charge is finalized. Is there anyone who is willing to volunteer for that opportunity? Want to raise your hand?
Okay. I normally would, right. But I know I'm overcommitted on a lot of things and I can't really take on the broadband area.
Okay.
I've been traveling a lot lately, but that may get better. I'll know in a week or two. So I'd like to hold off on volunteering, but I do have telecom experience. But anyway, I can't commit right now.
Okay.
And I have very little telecom experience or my broadband. You know, I have general knowledge, which may be useful. I have more policy knowledge. So depending on what skills we want to provide, I may not have them.
Okay. Well, the board has to nominate somebody from the board, the way the charge has been written and how it was approved at town meeting as an article. So let's defer this for now and we'll formally approve in September.
So, that's all we can do at Wendy, this point.
Yep.
That draft that we just saw actually showed it chosen by the board, not...
Yes, and that's why if we're not willing to, if we don't have anyone who can be nominated this month, we don't much have a choice until September again. So I have to just say, I can't be the chair and be on the fine audit committee and be on the broad committee. So I can't do that either. So I think that's going to be a challenge for us. Pam, you're on mute if you wanted to. Yeah,
I don't have it in front of me, but it's chosen by the board is not the same as, is the intent that it be a board member?
Yes.
I see. Okay, because there have been comments, including I think one I made and others have made about, or designee, and if that was the case, we'd be in a different situation, which might be more desirable, but that's not the case. I just want to...
Right.
Yeah, we thought that given the impact on the business, that it really made sense to have a board member as opposed to a designee. This really isn't an arm's length type of a situation.
Well, also, I did put in designee, and then someone pointed out to me... town meeting voted, it has to be a light board member.
Yeah.
That's how the article was written.
Okay. Right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, no, that makes sense. I just wanted a clarification. All makes sense. Thank you.
Right. All right, unless, I don't know, Gordon, if you'd be willing to volunteer and we can reevaluate it if your schedule changes.
Could, how about if maybe I'd be, I could do it if I could get someone to help share the clerk responsibilities?
Pam or Alice, any, can you help with clerk responsibilities?
Sure.
I'm really flat out.
Right, I can.
Alice, you know what? I very, very much appreciate your willingness to do that as you've done tonight. So with that, Gordon, can we nominate you as, or can someone make a nomination to nominate Gordon to be our representative to the broadband committee? I think I can do it.
I nominate Gordon to be the light board member on the new broadband committee once the charge is established.
Is there a second?
I second.
All right, I'll have to do a roll call. Alice?
Yes.
Pam?
Yes.
Wendy's a yes. Brian?
Yes, and thank you, Gordon.
Yes, and Gordon, you get to vote on yourself.
Yes.
Thank you. All right. So
note that if Gordon finds it taxing because of his travel schedule, I can do backup for you.
Okay.
Thank you.
That'd be great.
I'm hoping the travel will end soon.
Yeah. Well, Gordon, thank you very much. I appreciate it. The whole board does. So, all right. And I know we traditionally have liaison and public comments as well. I am looking at the attendees. I don't know if there's hands raised or people have comments or questions. I don't see them. Oh, I do see one from Dave Allen. David?
Wendy, also Matt Johnson has his
hand. Oh, sorry. Oh, all right. Sorry. I called on David, so let me have David.
So, quick. You can hear me, I trust. Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
I actually tried at the very beginning on just the question you raised, Wendy, about the format here for these virtual meetings. I appreciated the creativity you suggested if you stick with the webinar format to read out the names. For better or for worse, people come and go. The name list is not static. But a bunch more than that, frankly, I come down where Alice came down. I'm just going to say it out loud. It's more democratic. Instead of the hoi polloi out here getting the word from those up on high are going to tell us how it's going to be, this is a community meeting. And after all, that's what the Light Plan Board is. It's representing the community. And I have been forced to find out, as many of us have, about Zoom. And I am prepared to say to you definitively, Zoom bombing is not a problem anymore. You can easily take steps with a meeting that's got everybody in it so that you will not be Zoom bombed. In fact, Zoom itself took extraordinary measures early on when a problem arose. You can't have a meeting now without a password, for example. And there are other measures you can take as well. So I certainly would be responsive if somebody can point out to me where I'm wrong, but I'm fairly certain I'm not. So I believe that issue has gone away. It's not a threat. If the technical arrangements are well done so that folks can't get in. And I'll come back to, as I say, I come down the same place that Alice does. This much a full meeting where everybody's visible, much more fulfills the character of these meetings, and you can so easily do it. There's just no issue in town of any sort to do things that way. It even costs less because you're not in webinar mode. Thanks.
All right, thank you, David. Matt, I'm sorry, I couldn't see your little hand up there because of the reflection.
That's fine.
Go ahead.
I just really appreciated the E&E presentation, and I just wonder whether there's any opportunity for the light plant to make more strategic use of its liquidity. When you think about, you know, the balance of funds that's available by the light plant, that you could do either opportunistic buys based upon the spot market or upon strategic opportunities that are available. You could make direct investment in renewable infrastructure, or you could even make investments in new technologies, such as storage technologies or in fusion energy, with the idea that they could pay off. They could pay off several times over in the future. And when you consider that, you know, the town doesn't just have a day-to-day need for renewable energy or next generation energy sources, but has a long-term commitment and requirement for these things to happen, to, you know, just go out and say, well, okay, let's buy some RECs and, you know, here's what somebody's already developed, is a lot different proposition than saying, let's make a strategic investment here and let's end up 10 years down the road with the kind of energy infrastructure that we're really going to need to make this work.
Thanks, Matt. I think part of the focus on our strategy is looking at some of those strategies that we have and making sure that we're still needing to make those investments and that we're prioritizing them correctly. So, but good recommendations. Laura, I see your hand, and Brian, I see yours too, but Laura, you want to comment?
Yeah, so thank you for those comments, Mr. Johnson. I did want to mention that some of the items that you've mentioned are squarely in our sights in terms of investments. One of the most recently upcoming is the investment in new metering technology, which will further our ability to encourage solar generation in town, thereby reducing greenhouse gas emissions, limiting some of the locational basis risk that Annie pointed out. It will also help us with our energy efficiency measures and deferring peak-related investments by making it easier to spread usage, such as from electric vehicles out into lower use periods. And the other thing I just wanted to mention about that, so in addition, we've got some of those things on our sites, and certainly battery storage, utility scale battery storage is one of them, is that please don't mistake, you know, many people look at the CMLP balance sheet, see a bunch of money on it, and think that that money is available for disposition. And the thing you need to recognize about power delivery is it is an inherently extremely risky business. And one of the things we need to make sure we do at all costs, like the broadband, okay, is when things go bad, we need to be there. And by being there, I mean, we need to have sufficient liquidity to manage through various crises that can happen and probably will happen at some point in the future. So, yes, we need to focus on those investments that are going to be most important to the town. I wholeheartedly agree with you, and I really appreciate you bringing up those specific examples, some of which are on our radar, but also keep in mind that we do need to keep sufficient reserves in reserve to really prudently manage the risks of this business and truly deliver cost-effective energy to our citizens.
Thank you, Laura. Very well said. Appreciate that. Brian?
I just wanted to remind you that we have enough board members to approve the April minutes.
Okay. Thanks for that reminder.
Yep. And Pamela Drake is next.
Okay. Thank you. I can see that. Pamela?
Hi. Thank you. I want to agree with Matt and Dave. I want to point out that most of the town board meetings do not use webinar and do not have any problem. And it is, for instance, a wonderful advantage as an audience member to have the reactions button include thumbs up. It doesn't include any thumbs down type things, but it does include thumbs up, which allows us to react and for you to see it when you come up with something that we think is important. And it allows us to be appreciative. And I don't see any reason why why the light board needs to take precautions that the select board does not, and the zoning board of appeals. So please switch back. And also, I really appreciate the things that Laura and David and the light board are doing to try to take the long view of powering Concord in a green way and responding to the town meeting initiatives, because getting from where we are to there is not easy and requires all kinds of manipulations and leaps in things that aren't your traditional business plan, which is just to sell electricity and deliver electricity. Has there been anyone considering the idea that the nuclear metals site that the town is going to take over, which is going to need a massive amount of land removed there, could be used, for example, as a sand battery, heat battery? There is all kinds of good new technologies for doing that. And that would be an industrial size storage that might be a perfect location for it. Scandinavian countries are doing that there for solar storage during winter times when they have long winters.
Right, thank you, Pamela. I appreciate the comments, and I'm sure that Dave and the team is looking to see, you know, where that that property can be best leveraged for the town as well. And actually, just to the earlier comment, Gordon and Pam, we'll talk about this next time, but we started this, one of the agenda items that you both missed was a discussion around Zoom and my attempt to have a collective input by the board on which format is preferred, discussing the option of identifying who the attendees were verbally a couple times during the meeting. So we'll revisit that in September. I'm not going to do that now because we're over time. But I do actually want to take Brian's idea. Well, we voted on minutes in your absence. We've approved the March and the May meeting, but we're unable to approve the April meeting due to a lack of quorum. So I'd like to reconsider if you had any feedback on the April minutes first, and then like to take a vote on those minutes. So did you, either of you, have any additional feedback on the last version of the April minutes?
No.
No, okay. Can I entertain a motion for someone to approve the April minutes as drafted? And these were, go ahead.
I move that we approve the April minutes.
Is there a second?
A second.
Thanks, Brian. All right, I'll do a roll call. Gordon, for the minutes. Yes, Pam?
Yes.
Brian?
Yes.
Alice?
Same.
Yep, and Wendy approves as well. Great, thank you. So we've got all our minutes approved. Appreciate that. I do not see any additional hands raised. So with that, I think I'd like to have a vote to adjourn the meeting. Do I have a motion? Is that Alice? Okay, second. Brian. All right, roll call. Alice.
Yes.
Brian.
Yes.
Gordon. To adjourn the meeting. Yes. Okay, thanks, Pam.
Yeah.
All right, me too. All right, thank you all. And I apologize for being so far over on this meeting.
And I apologize for dropping in late. I just got my dates confused. I'm ashamed, I'm embarrassed about that.
Okay, well.
I apologize too.
Okay. All right, well, you can all sleep late tomorrow morning. Thank you.
Take care, everyone.
All right, bye-bye.